Can you hear anything? No? Well, that's a huge problem because this working smoke detector should be freaking out right now, but it thinks everything is just fine. For decades, some firefighters and scientists have been claiming that the most common smoke alarms Americans use are dangerously flawed.
Did not go off until the room was filled with thick smoke.
They will not detect certain types of common fires in a home in a timely fashion.
The most common type has an alarming rate of failure.
Oh, and here's the insidious part. If I move that same smoke alarm to my kitchen where I'm cooking food and I open the door, I think many of you know what's about to happen. Why is it alarming over nothing? Why is it alarming over nothing, but also ignoring dangerous smoke? I got to the bottom of this, and I want to show you how a flurry of engineering, science, and regulation came together to save our lives, but also left us with a dangerous blind spot in detecting fires. By the end, we'll find out how this smoke alarm sausage is made, and supposedly how these issues have finally been fixed in 2024 with these, the new generation of alarms. Let's talk about what that means and whether you can stop waving the white towel.
This video is brought to you by Novium. More on them later.
Most of you know what a smoke alarm does. Sense a fire and make a loud sound to get you out. The earliest alarms started to be commercially available in the 1890s, and these were really simple, a thermometer and an alarm. But the problem is when a fire starts in another room. By the time the heat reaches the detector, your home is burning and you probably aren't making it out alive. So inventors thought, why don't we detect smoke instead? You could see signs of a fire way before any heat reaches you. In the 1930s, the ionization alarm was invented, and today make up 87% of all American alarms, probably the ones you have at home. But to understand why they're not detecting some types of smoke, we need to take a closer look at the sensor.
So let's pop off the dome and see what's inside. Whoa, radiation. In the middle is a small radioactive puck shooting out alpha particles like a miniature firework show. Ionizing, aka charging the air above it with electricity, which creates an electric current that the alarm can monitor. When smoke crashes the party, it's packed with a whole ton of smoke particles that act like a group of bullies, knocking away the alpha particles and dropping the flow of electricity. As more of these troublemakers rush in, the current takes a nosedive, and once it falls below a certain point, the alarm goes off, letting you know there's a problem.
This new technology was a game changer. By the 70s, these alarms were selling by the millions and have saved tens of thousands of lives since.
They've also brought with them a new source of frustration.
I could be cooking and seeing no smoke and the fire alarm goes off. And then you're panicking, you have to go get a towel to wave at the fire alarm, and it's all really stressful.
So then what's the cause of all these false alarms?
Turns out when you're cooking a meal, there's a whole bunch of particles flying out of your food, and most of them are too small to see with your naked eye. But your ionization alarm is a massive flood of particles that look just like smoke, that quickly drop the voltage, and then, how annoying.
But here's the thing, that same sensitivity that drives you crazy is actually a lifesaver when it comes to detecting a type of fire called a flaming fire. You know, when you're cooking, you get distracted because you're chatting up your girl, and your food suddenly catches on fire? Flaming fire. This also gives off a ton of tiny particles that an ionization alarm quickly reacts to, giving you time to put it out or escape your home.
So then, why is it sleeping on the job here? Turns out, the sensor is detecting them, but it needs more smoke before it goes off because this is a different type of fire, and it produces a different type of smoke particle. Let me explain.
Let's say you're at home and you go to sleep with a cigarette in your hand, or more likely today, your power strip overheats and it starts burning material. There's no flame, but a ton of smoke. This is a smoldering fire.
Just like what's happening here, notice no flame, but it's burning. Zoom in, and the smoke particles this time are huge, which is why the smoke is so visible compared to what was coming out of the oven. So then, why isn't the alarm going off? That's because smoldering fires release way fewer particles, and an ionization sensor is all about the number of particles. It can actually see how thick the smoke is. So smoldering smoke keeps building and building before it finally goes off. And during this time, it's filling your home with an especially toxic smoke.
Now imagine you're sleeping. Your sense of smell is on vacation. Here comes carbon monoxide and other chemicals that put you into a deeper and deeper sleep forever.
But let's say the smoke doesn't get you. Get out of here, nobody likes you. If you don't extinguish a smoldering fire fast enough.
Thanks to modern construction, your sofa or mattress can become a roaring inferno in as little as 3 minutes, compared to 17 plus in vintage furniture. And that's because older furniture was made from natural materials like linen and cotton. Today, we use synthetic materials as they're cheaper, easier to clean, but they also burn way faster thanks to their chemical structure. Check this out. Natural materials are like a net. They're bound together and require more time and energy to break apart, while synthetic materials are like gasoline for fire, simple, uniform, and quick to release energy.
When working on my animations, I sometimes reach for paper to think through ideas like whether I would show the double bonds in natural materials that slow down how quickly things burn. This is where Novium, the sponsor of today's video, comes in handy. As someone who values high quality tools and curates my desk for productivity, I've fallen in love with their HoverPen 2.0 Interstellar Edition. This pen is a joy to hold and write with. Crafted from die-cast aluminum, it's solid and well-balanced. Not only does it look amazing on my desk, it's also a satisfying fidget device as the dock uses magnets to allow it to spin without batteries. Gives me a way to relieve a bit of stress when I'm working on a difficult idea. As a fan of Marie Kondo, I want a place for everything, and the dock gives me a dedicated home for my pen. No more searching for when inspiration strikes. It's always right there, ready to go. The HoverPen uses the German-made Schmidt D1 cartridges, which means the ink flows smoothly and evenly while writing. And when it runs out, there's a refill included. I chose black to match my desk, but you might be different, and there's three colors to choose from, including a premium 18-karat gold-plated edition. If you're a space fan, I got you. Check out the meteorite embedded version featuring a piece from outer space. They also gave me the HoverPen 3.0 Future Edition, which can go from a rollerball tip to a fountain pen. As someone who used to use a fountain pen daily, I love the unique feel and look you get from them. If you want this or the 2.0, winner one of Time Magazine's Best Inventions of 2022 for yourself or as a great gift, check out the link in the description below or use the QR codes, one for UK and Europe and another for the rest of the world. Using my link gets you a 10% discount on all HoverPens and free shipping to most countries. Now, let's get back to the story on ionization alarms and how they were slow to the smoldering fire party.
Ionization alarms were accused of being too slow to save your life in a fire.
So couldn't manufacturers just increase the sensitivity? Problem solved, right? Well, not quite, as false alarms would happen even more. And I think we know what most people will do next. Wow, this is a problem, and starting in the 90s, this was getting public attention.
They don't detect smoke. They're nothing more than a flame detector.
I would have had the visibility in order to fire those keys, open that door, and get me and my children out of there, and I wouldn't be talking to you today.
There are many people in graves today in Australia because they thought that they had the right type of alarm when they didn't.
When he says the right type, he's talking about these, a photoelectric alarm. And according to some firefighters and scientists, these will save your life in a fire.
If we could wave the magic wand right now and eliminate all the ionization smoke alarms and replace them with a photoelectric, in the U.S. we would save 1,500 lives a year. We would cut our fire deaths in half.
To understand why they thought photoelectric was so much better, let's get inside and see what makes it tick.
The most important change is the sensor. And once I lift the dome, it looks completely different underneath, as it now uses a light source and a light detector, not radiation, to pick up smoke. Under normal conditions, an LED creates light, which bounces off the dome and away from the light sensor. But if we add a little smoke, the light scatters and the sensor can detect more and more light until it passes a threshold, triggering the alarm. Remember the large but few particles in smoldering smoke? Now it's easily seen and easily detected. And those pesky cooking particles? they remain invisible until you start burning your food, which means you'll have far less false alarms that come out of nowhere.
So those ionization haters were telling everyone, ban ionization. Photoelectric is the way to go. There's opposition though, other experts and manufacturers who are like, whoa, hold on, slow your roll. Photoelectric sensors have a weakness. They take longer at detecting flaming fires compared to ionization, as visible smoke needs to build up first. Trouble was, no one in the 90s really knew who was right, as the current studies were inconclusive. The government caught in the middle, feeling the heat, and were like, fine, I'll do it myself.
In the early 2000s, a few agencies came together and forked over $1 million to NIST, the National Institute of Standards and Technology. They bought buildings and wired them up with fancy equipment and set different kinds of fires to understand how that affects smoke alarms. For example, how a smoldering chair in the living room will produce a different result from a flaming mattress in the bedroom or cooking oil in the kitchen area. In the end, 50 tests were run looking at variables like type of detectors, their location, and whether doors were open or closed.
That study produced this, 396 pages worth of documentation that only nerds would love. Luckily for us, there's an official Q&A that summarizes, do ionization detectors provide enough time to save lives? And here's what they found.
In flaming fires, both types of alarms provided enough time for you to escape, with ionization being a little faster. In smoldering fires, ionization still gives you enough time to escape, but this time, photoelectric is faster, by 30 minutes.
Huge, big. This was a smoking gun for ionization critics.
See you in hell.
They used this data to lobby and require photoelectric alarms to be used in a few states. But unfortunately for them, the study came to a different conclusion that both types of alarms are safe. Most states kept the status quo. Legally, you can use any alarm, but they recommend in the fine print, you should really have both types for the best protection. Of course, barely anyone knows this, and it never fixed the real problem. Why can't we go to a store and buy a smoke alarm that works against all fires? Well, good news, that finally exists. You just need to look for the new 8th generation of smoke alarms. To understand, we need to talk about who actually decides what's safe. You see, I used to think the government handled all safety standards, but by the powers of the federal government, private companies like UL are given the authority to set safety rules on some products that manufacturers have to follow. This includes smoke alarms, and in America, that standard is called UL217, and starting June 30th, 2024, all newly produced alarms must follow the new 8th generation standard, which finally fixes the problems found in the government test. The first deals with false alarms from cooking. A hamburger is broiled, and these new alarms have to resist the smoke created until there is a dense amount of it. Second, it needs to quickly detect smoldering polyurethane foam. Remember this? That's polyurethane, and over the last 40 years, it has become the primary cushioning material in things like your mattress, pillows, and sofa.
It's also the deadly reason behind the 30-minute delay in ionization alarms. When polyurethane foam smolders, it produces 10 times less particles than the paper and wood used in UL's older tests. And ionization alarms, which rely on detecting particle numbers, are incredibly slow at detecting this new, common, and dangerous type of fire.
But all of that has finally been fixed with these new 8th generation alarms. And they're available right now, just like this one. Wait, what? This is an ionization alarm? It passed the new standards? When we talk about how ionization was no good, well, I did some research and the solution is ingenious.
In 2015, UL commissioned this enormous study on the characteristics of smoke, most importantly documenting what different types of smoke look like to different sensors. Like this graph, which shows how an ionization sensor sees smoldering wood and foam as being very different than broiling hamburgers. Manufacturers use data like this to create new detection algorithms for 8th generation alarms, which are far more complicated than older generation models that set off the alarm once smoke goes over a programmed threshold. In comparison, in 8th generation alarms, as smoke levels approach a threshold, it starts a gigabrain mode. It's analyzing the data coming in, seeing how fast it's rising, the smoothness, etc., to see if it's a real fire or cooking smoke.
This is a simplified explanation of how decades of science and engineering finally came together to fix the problems with smoke alarms in America. We could stop waving the white flag. So you might be wondering, should you rush out and replace your alarms with these 8th generation models? First of all, check if the ones you have actually work. An old model is better than nothing. On what to replace, here's my thoughts. If you have ionization-only alarms in your house, if any are older than 10 years, or they go off while you're cooking, it's time to replace them. You can check if your alarm is ionization by looking at the back, see if it has an I logo or says ionization or radiation. As of May 2024, only 3 companies offer 8th generation smoke alarms. And if you're looking to get one, I put together a comprehensive guide with my personal recommendations and additional research that'll save you time and energy, helping you to decipher critical features like interconnection, which links up all the alarms in your home. You can find that guide in the description below. Finally, check out our sponsor, Novium. I really like their HoverPen 2.0 Interstellar Edition. It writes wonderfully and it's a fantastic addition to my desk. It also makes for a great gift. Use the link below in the description. Thanks to all of you who are still watching. This has taken months to put together and I hope this makes a difference in your life. See you in the next one. Subscribe for more.